Okay, guys, if you ever plan to run a Ford Taurus or a Mercury Sable of any year, all the way up to 07, I think this is going to be the same scenario for, maybe even past that, I haven't touched anything newer than 07 yet, then this is going to be a video for you. So stay tuned on what's coming in this video, and there's going to be helpful build info on this. So quick update on what you see here in front of you. We have the Sable coming back together. We have the fiberglass core support and radiator mounts all from my wagon. That stuff was all usable. I had saved that back. I knew it someday I'd probably run another one. So good thing I did, because it kind of fits. We ended up getting it back in the original position. It's bolted there and there in the factory spot. It just doesn't quite sit down there like it should. You see these clips here? That's supposed to be that bolt. That bolt right there is supposed to be that bolt, and those bolts are all supposed to bolt into this. So this top piece right here is literally spray foamed in place. I just jammed some spray foam, glued it down, called it good. Oh well, I don't care. That's not the important part of your fiberglass. The part that matters on these is right here to here, this corner connection. That's what truly holds this thing in. That and those brackets that are down there clipped to it. It's literally the only thing that hold these in. Once those brackets shatter and those corners go, this whole thing just drops down on the ground. So I'm hoping I'll probably wire it to the hood or something, just loop something through there to help hold it up in case those break. Typical Ford Taurus issues and problems. But good to see that. You guys saw the test run. This thing is doing okay. Still a little funky on that throttle. I can't figure it out. But you know what? Once it warms up, the issue seems to go away and get a heck of a lot better. But the first 5 minutes or so, it is very, very iffy. It loves to sputter and sput around when it's in idle, step on the gas, and then when you let off, it just holds those RPMs like you're still hitting it for a good 10 seconds longer. I don't know. This is officially the possessed engine. I don't care. We're running this thing's bone stock pretty much, so we're out to have some fun. We're going to kill this car off. And yes, if you haven't caught on, those videos you saw were older videos. I actually started building this car a good bit ago. Was originally going to run this thing at the Jay County Fair, Portland, Indiana. That was the plan. So I had started on this thing way long ago, and then with all the crazy stuff going on, we decided to push it back into a different derby, and we were going to run the Buick. The 2004 Buick LeSabre was going to run at Portland instead. But then, after Portland combined the Derby of 2 days into 1 day, I knew as soon as they announced it that they were not going to do heats for these front-wheel drives. Portland is lately, the last 3 years now, you've seen it, I go there every year, I love the place, but they have just gotten terrible about the front-wheel drive, shoving them into one arena. I mean, yeah, they made the arena longer, don't get me wrong, they could fit more cars in it, but the problem is they put so many in there, it's a boring show for the crowd, you can't see half the hits. The cars themselves, most of those cars at Portland, I know you guys saw me film it, but you didn't see me after I turned the camera off. I am not joking. I'm talking 50% of the cars, the front-wheel drive, bone-stock cars at Portland, when that derby was over, most of them drove out of that arena. They either lost just because they overheated, because they were bumping around, lost water, and couldn't do much else, or they got a flat tire, got stuck against a dead car, couldn't get off of it, or just stuck in the mud. No joke. That's pretty crazy. That really sucks as a driver and someone in the crowd when you just watch a good derby. I know they couldn't divide them up because it was a one-day derby because of the whole apocalypse going on. They had to do that. But I'm really, really hoping someone's going to convince them in the future when Jay County Fair 2021 comes around, they need to put those front-wheel drive cars into heats. I know people don't want to fix their cars. It stinks. So, I mean, your only option is you either take those front-wheel drive and you do multiple payout features. Do like 20 cars with one winner, 20 cars, one winner, something like that. Something so they have room to drive, make hits, put on a show. Or you're going to have to just do heats in a feature, and people are going to have to assume that's how it's going to go. You loop your lines if you blow the radiator. Bring a loop kit if you need to. Bring a spare donut or something on your car. You know, back in the old days when we ran full-size bone stock, that's what we did. If you couldn't afford radiators or tires, you just used what you had. You switched a flat tire from the front to the back or back to the front, whatever was your best wheel. You went out there and had fun with it. They're going to have to, or the front-wheel drive class is just, it's going to get really boring and really impossible to win unless you sit in a corner and bag. As much as I hate to say that, that's the only way you're going to place when there's 50, 60 cars thrown into arena. You got to just pick a wall, make a campsite, throw up a fire for a while, and when everyone else is done hitting each other and you're done toasting marshmallows, you drive into the middle of the arena and you fight it out when there's 10 cars left. It's crazy. So that is why I didn't run Portland this year. It's why the Buick LeSabre build got pushed off, didn't happen. It's why this thing was delayed, didn't happen. I'm building it now for the fall. A little bit of backstory there. Sorry I went off on a bit of a tangent, but really, really hope somebody from Portland hears this video and gets the idea across. People want to run more of your shows. We want to have fun with these front wheel drives. It's the biggest class, the biggest car count you're getting out there. Support that. Help those people. So, back to this car. We've thrown it all together. Radiator's in there. The thing runs, drives pretty darn good. Brakes are still working. Check this out over here. If you follow my Facebook fan page, that's right, guys, we're back using the fan page. A lot of you have been asking and asking. I was actually out of it for a while. I didn't have it set up through my personal page, had it set up through a secondary Facebook page. Big nuisance. Finally got that all fixed. So I am active on there. Hopefully get some time to respond to messages on the inbox. I get a ton of inbox messages from you guys for build questions and stuff. So be patient with me there. But if you want sneak peeks on what I'm working on, or if you want reminded of videos that are coming out, maybe a whole playlist of events I film, places I'm going to, travels, follow on the fan page. It's Demolition Missions on Facebook. If you saw on there, you see we got the door changed out, guys. We did it. You can see the before and after pictures I took when the door was off. Honestly, worked out pretty well. I thought it'd be a problem. The other door, all I did was cut the 9-wire. I peeled this fender and that fender, or the door in the fender open, so I could get down in there with a socket, and all I did was undo the hinge bolts, leaving the hinges on the actual car, but undoing the bolts to the door. The door, literally, I reached in, undid the handle, and the door kicked right open, swung open, fell off the hinges. Couldn't believe it was that easy with that mangled of a door. With that being said, that was a 2004 Sable door. This here is a 1999 Taurus wagon door, and I'm here to tell you, they do match up. The stuff is all the same, the window frame is the same, the hinges are all in the exact same place. Very surprised how easy it was for me to do that. It just took a little bit of time. With one person, I had to put ratchet straps. Here's a tip for you guys. I put a ratchet strap around the door, around this frame and around this window when the door was sitting on the ground. And then I put a ratchet strap here in the corner and ran it all the way back to this corner. And by doing that, the door was on the ground. I used my ratchet straps like a crane, and you can slowly reel in the strapping to pull the door upwards, so you get your height for those hinges, and then you crank on this one to pull the door backwards into this corner. Once I had it roughly where I wanted it, I took a sledgehammer, smacked it, and it kind of wedged itself in place, because let's be honest, this car has seen better days, and it's kind of buckled a little bit around in there. And you can see down there where the floor is actually coming from the old door being pushed in. So we've shoved all that in there, and then once I had those ratchet straps holding it in place, I could swing it a little bit, and I got one bolt in. Once you get one bolt in, it's easy there. You just tighten that up a little bit, and you do the rest all the way down. This thing's back on the hinges. It's latched in place. 9 wires back around the door. We're good to go. Probably going to want to repaint that a little bit so it don't stick out like a big old target. We'll see if that door gets screwed up just as much as the other one did. But that's the updates on this car. Let's get to the juicy part of the video. What I told you in the beginning, there's some really good build advice you're going to want for Tauruses and Sables. So what do we got going on right now? Well, there's the CV axle out of the driver's side. It's still good. I pulled it out. Didn't mean to take the cup with it, but you know what? It kind of came out. Here's the strut. It is indeed bent. Didn't realize it was this bad until I actually pulled it out of the car. Some of that was quite hidden in the actual connector of where this goes in place. So, didn't think it was that bad looking at it with my eyes. I did leave the passenger side right now. I'll show you. Here's my passenger side. It's already got the rim. It's got the tire. Everything's mounted on there. Good to go. I have not changed that out yet. It seemed okay when I was looking at it. Even this rim here looks pretty straight, like it's not leaning in. I think most of the damage was driver's side. We're going to find out. And no, there's nothing going on with the steering that I can find. Check this out. Even though my tires are something funky going on with the steering on them, they will not point the same way perfectly. One of them is always about 4 inches the other direction than the other. It's straight as can be, both sides, even up under in those boots up in there. There's nothing wrong with them. So I'm hoping that means it was because of the struts being collapsed and twisted, that the steering was not able to work to its full potential. We know my Camry did that. Let's hope this is the same issue. So we got all that out, struts out, A-arm still in place. But what else are we doing, and what are we going to talk about? Well, this is huge news for you guys. So, Looking under here, you will notice something's missing. That's the motor mount. I have taken it completely out of this Sable. Now, whether you are running the 3.0 early 2000s engine, whether you're running the 90s Vulcan engine, the 3.0 Vulcan engine, the pushrod engine, or you're running this engine here, which is the, show it to you, Duratec V6 dual overhead can, the one that has two belts, one belt there, one belt over there, that engine, they're all the same motor mount right here, and it's all the same problem. I had this happen. This took me out in the Derby with Karen the Killer Compact, and that was a 1990 Taurus. So from 86 all the way to 2007, literally 20 years now, no, more than 20 years, we've had this same exact problem with Ford. They have never fixed their motor mounts to be any better. They're absolute crap right here on the driver's side. So what happened in the Derby when Susan ran this car? This motor mount was probably already weak, but I've seen it every time on a Ford I've ran. Every single one of them will break this motor mount. And this bracket sits right in here. There's a piece of rubber right here. And what happens is you see this cup here that is rusted like crazy. Ignore that. But this guy bolts up in there. All I do is take that nut off. I put a jack under the engine, jack the engine up, pull this thing out. So this normally sits right here with the rubber glued or pressed into place. I have no idea. I've never seen one fully in good condition. So it sits right in there, and what happens is over time, the vibrations and the stress on this car from shifting just wear this ring out, and the rubber is supposed to be connected. It's ripped it apart. This rubber piece is junk, and it bolts in right there. You can replace it and put a brand new rubber mount right there. I don't know if this cup comes with that rubber mount. Get a new one of these because it's gone. I'm going to go junkyard hunting or even online to find a new one at cheap prices to put in here, get this thing replaced. So what happens when these things break? Well, a couple things. If you have a car that has the column shifter, you've heard me preach and preach about these cars, how much I hate the column shifters. Well, this is why they break. This motor mount comes loose, it breaks open. When that engine shifts just a little bit, that cable column shifter is mounted to this unibody frame on the other side, right here, on the other side of it, and to the transmission. When the transmission rocks, it has no stretch, no give to this frame, and it just pulls that cable extra long, stretches it out, the little housing around the cable blows apart, and then when you go to shift, the cable blows out of that housing, and it can't fully push the shifter lever. So that means your shifter can only pull the cable lever. That means if you're pulling the cable lever, that's going down on your column shifter. So eventually you'll end up all the way in low gear and drive going forwards, and you can never get back to reverse, park, or neutral to restart the car. That's a huge problem, and that is why all these stupid shifters break on all these Fords. This Sable is a floor shifter, so it did not break that shifter during the Derby when this motor mount broke. That's the benefit of the floor shifter. The way it's mounted, it does not tie into this frame. Also, if you look and measure the difference in length, the floor shifter is just slightly longer than the column shifter, giving it a little bit more stretch and give when the engine rocks around. So if you can get a floor shifter out of a car, and I don't know if the interchange between the Duratec and the 3.0, I'm going to say no, but maybe. If you can get a floor shifter and save it and find a way to make it work to replace the column shifter, then you are ahead of your game for these Fords. But let's talk about the other bit of the thing that happens. We talked about Karen the Killer Compact. What took that car out? If you remember way back, that was a full weld compact. Tons of reinforcement done on that car. What didn't save that car, though, is this motor mount. It broke, even though I had it chained, it broke loose and was just rocking back and forth with that chain still moving. When it did that, this bracket, this tip, that corner, and this bolt that goes through there and sticks out. See how that sticks out back in there? That is just a big old spear. And what happened with Karen, the 1990 Taurus, is the end of that bolt stabbed into the side of that transmission, punched straight through it, put a hole in it, all the fluid drained out, that car no longer moved. That's why that car got fourth place instead of a top three finish. Other than that, it would have made that finish. So, if you look close, guys, what do I see on this car? Do you see it? Yep, I do, right there. That is not a mark, that's an indent in the actual housing. There's a bit of a lip right there. where this car, this transmission, has slammed over and smashed off the side of this corner right here and started punching itself into the transmission. Had this car lasted longer in the Derby and Susan kept driving it, there's a pretty good chance, because of how bad that rotor mount was broken, this thing would have kept shifting over, especially on a really hard hit to the side fenders of this car when it throws the transmission left and right, that this thing would keep pounding against here until it cracked open the transmission or put a hole in it. All the fluid drains out and this car is done forever permanently unless you go and take the time, put a whole new transmission. That is not worth the effort on one of these stock front wheel drive cars. So we've saved this car just barely in time. While I was down here pulling that strut out, getting ready to fix that strut, that's when I saw that mark. And I knew, as soon as I saw the mark, I knew exactly what was going on. I put a pry bar right here. I lifted up on that motor mount. The whole thing came up and moved around. And I told myself, we are not going to lose because of that reason this time. This may be a hurt car, but I want the chance to ruin this car correctly. I want to bend the frame. I want to cause as much damage as I can to my own vehicle. And we're not going to kill the transmission. So, how do you avoid that? Well, you make sure this mount's not broken. Put a brand new one in there if you want. Heck, go buy a brand new one. And every time you run one of these cars, use that same motor mount. Just put it in every car with a solid piece of rubber that replaces it. Unless your rules allow you, you can run a piece of chain or weld it solid if the rules allow. Mine are all stock, so we'll replace it, put it in a brand new piece of rubber, hold that thing down nice and good. But always, always do something about that. And even then, if you want, if you can find a way to shorten these bolts so they don't stick out the other end of that thing, then you don't have a spear to stab your transmission. And honestly, I am tempted right now to take a cutting wheel and just cut off the top of this bracket right here above this hole and get rid of that nub so it can't stab against the transmission like it is doing. Because when this guy goes on here, it doesn't need that top bracket. I'll even cut this one off. It only needs that bolt hole to bolt together. Especially for a Derby, I don't need that top piece completely there. So I may shorten the corner of this one and that one, shave them off a bit, buy it some room. But that is really good information. If you guys ever want to run a lot of Fords, a lot of Sables, Tauruses, this is a very common problem. The exact same transmission mount has been used for all those years from 86 until 2007. So there's your demolition missions, building advice of the day. Hopefully this will help somebody else. I want to see these Fords just do a little bit better out there in these Derbies. Got to bring them back up to the top so they can compete with the Camrys and the Luminas. But there you have it, guys. Getting back to work on this thing. As you can see now, we're caught up in all my videos. We are in the modern time, not behind the scenes. A month ago like we were before, there's the trailer. There's the Sonata that is going to hopefully run sometime. Don't know when. Every time I pick a show for that thing, it gets canceled every single time. So that car is kind of cursed right now. I'm afraid to even pick another event because it will probably get canceled. But stay tuned. I still want to run that thing this year. This car comes next. Oh, and don't forget, we still have a rear-wheel drive vehicle that's hiding that we're going to build for this year. I'm determined to build it, but I got to get this car done really soon so we can get to it. And it is not a compact. There's my next hint. Everybody commented. I had like 50 comments. Everybody trying to guess what it's going to be. It is not a compact mini vehicle. Not a Mustang, not a Camaro, Pacer, any of that stuff. It is rear-wheel drive, and it is a big vehicle. So stay tuned, guys. More videos coming your way.